Please see the link in the description to download a worksheet for this video. Experiments can be dangerous. If you are a child, never do experiments unless your parent, guardian, or adult educator says it's all right and is there with you the whole time. If you've not already done so, we suggest that you watch the video on States of Matter Part 1 before watching this video. Let's start with an experiment. We've added green food coloring to the water in these test tubes. The test tubes and the mitten are all about the same temperature. We'll put one of the test tubes inside the mitten, then come back later. Which test tube do you think will be warmer when we return? To predict what will happen, we have to know a little bit about how heat moves to and from objects, and to and from places. Instead of using the word move, when talking about heat, we usually use the word transfer. In this video, we'll talk about three common ways that heat transfers, which are 1. Conduction, 2. Convection, and 3. Radiation. Heat will only transfer using one of these three ways if the temperatures are different between two objects or places. In our first experiment, the starting temperatures were the same for the mitten and test tubes. That means there will be no heat transfer. That's why all the temperatures are the same after the experiment. In contrast, if the temperature is different, then there will be heat transfer from the hot object or place to the colder object or place. That's why hot air on a summer day will transfer heat to a cold ice cream and melt it. And that's why a hot drink will transfer heat to the cooler room air. And in the process, the drink gets cooler. Now, we'll discuss heat transfer due to conduction. Let's start with an experiment. This towel and metal block are about 70 degrees. This man's hands are about 91 degrees. Even though the block and towel are the same temperature, he says that the metal feels cooler than the towel. After a few minutes, the hand that was on the towel is now 2 degrees hotter than it was before, but the hand that was on the metal block is now 5 degrees colder than it was before. Why did his hands change temperature? To answer that question, we need to learn about heat transfer due to conduction. If we put some cold butter on a hot frying pan, then the butter gets hot very quickly and melts. That's because they're different temperatures and they're touching each other. Some of the heat of the frying pan has transferred to the butter. Heat transfer due to conduction happens when two objects that are different temperatures touch each other. If you touch a warm cup of hot chocolate, your hands will get warmer due to conduction. If you stand on hot sand at a beach, your feet will get warmer due to conduction. Many times we want to block heat transfer due to conduction. For example, we wear boots in the winter when walking on snow to block heat from transferring from our feet to the snow. We use oven mitts to prevent heat from transferring from a hot dish to our hands. If an object transfers heat well, like metal pots, we call them good heat conductors. If an object transfers heat poorly, like this wooden spoon or the plastic handles of this pot, we call them good insulators. Alternatively, we could say that good insulators are poor heat conductors. Another name for heat is thermal. So sometimes we'll refer to how well an object conducts heat by describing its thermal conductivity. Now we're ready to explain our experiment. At the start of the experiment, this man's hands were about 20 degrees hotter than the objects. When he touched the metal block, heat transferred from his right hand to the metal block, because metal is a good conductor of heat. But when he touched the towel, no heat transferred from his left hand, because cloth is a poor conductor of heat, which means cloth is a good insulator. In a way, it's like he had his left hand partly in a mitten that kept heat from the bottom of his hand from transferring to the room's air. So the heat coming from his body and going into his left hand did not leave his hand, and his hand then got even hotter. Next, let's look at heat transfer due to convection. It's only 45 degrees outside, yet this flask has kept this lady's coffee hot for more than 5 hours. This flask is almost identical to the lady's one, but instead of filling it with something hot, a scientist uses it to store liquid nitrogen. Liquid nitrogen is more than 300 degrees below zero Fahrenheit. Flasks like these are very common. They don't use any energy, yet they can keep hot things hot or cold things cold. Why are they so effective? To answer that question, we first need to learn about heat transfer due to convection. If it's a cold day, we can get warm if there's hot air coming through the vents. That hot air flows by us and makes us warm. Or if it's a hot day, then cold air from the air conditioner cools us down. On my conduction, there's no object that we're touching that makes us warm or cold. It's the hot air that warms us up or the cold air that cools us down. Convection happens when the movement of a gas, like air or a liquid, transfers heat between an object and its environment. One way to remember convection refers to air or liquid movement is to think of the letter V, which could stand for air vents. Even if the air conditioner is off, a fan can make us feel cooler. Our body temperature is about 100 degrees Fahrenheit. If the room is cooler than our bodies, then as the fan moves air, that air will transfer heat from our bodies to the room's environment. Convection can involve liquids instead of air. This dog is very hot, but by sitting in some cool water, the water's flow is transferring heat from the dog's hot body to the cooler environment. This cow is also being cooled by convection, since she's standing on the edge of the ocean and getting some cool water on her legs. Jumping in a swimming pool is a great way to cool down on a hot summer day. A car's cooling system circulates radiator fluid that cools the engine. All of these are examples of heat transfer by convection. Now let's return to our question about how these flasks do such a good job. Here's a drawing of the inside of the flask. There's a large gap between the outer wall and the inner wall. That gap is a partial vacuum. A perfect vacuum is impossible to achieve, but even a partial one is almost empty space. Without any air or fluid between the walls, there can be no convection that transfers heat between the contents of the bottle and the environment. Because this is a partial vacuum, eventually there will be heat transfer, but not for a long time. Now, let's look at heat transfer due to radiation. This space heater is hot. We can see some of its heat as orange light waves coming from the wires. But there are other energy waves coming from it that we cannot see that are called infrared waves. All of these energy waves are transferring its heat to the room by thermal radiation. This small device detects airflow and shows us there's no airflow between the space heater and the sheet metal. That means there's no convection making the sheet metal hot. The sheet metal is getting hot due to radiation from the space heater. Every day, the sun warms the side of the Earth that's facing the sun. There's no air or liquid between the sun and the Earth, so there's no convection. The Earth and the sun are not touching, so there's no conduction. Instead, the heat is transferred from the sun to the Earth by radiation as high-energy beams of sunlight. Sunlight causes heat transfer by radiation. When the sun is shining, it's always hotter in the direct sun than in the shade. For example, this grass is about 15 degrees hotter in the direct sun than in the shade. That's why an umbrella that blocks some sunlight at the beach can make things feel cooler. In the shade, there's less heat transferred from the sun by radiation. That's why it's always cooler in the shade. Here's a summary of this topic and some extra information. Please pause the video if you wish to read this. If you're interested in practice tests that are similar to state exams, but with detailed, colorful explanations for each answer, then please see our apps in the App Store. Many of these are free and none expire or limit their function. Since we only make educational products for children, none of our apps have third-party advertising, in-app purchasing, or connect to the internet. Please subscribe if you'd like to be notified of future educational videos we make. Thanks for your attention.